right? I must first make a disclaimer, of course, that I'm not speaking in the name of the court. I'm only speaking in my own personal name, as somebody who has been here for 15 years and who is to some extent informed of what is going on. The aggrieved party in this case, if it were to happen, is of course one of the citizens of Germany, France, Italy, of any of the EU countries, or countries concerned that have signed the European Convention on Human Rights, 47 countries, and that person would have to bring a case before the domestic courts, exhaust all the domestic remedies on the issue, and then bring it to the European Court of Human Rights, which again might take years to materialize. In the European Court of Human Rights, of course, we never had a case of that kind of massive electronic surveillance of citizens. And of course, it's therefore very difficult to say what would happen, except that the country, the United Kingdom, France, Germany, any of the involved country who has collaborated with NSA on this problem, would have to be a sued party, would have to be involved as a defender in this particular case, and then of course the question would be how would it defend itself in front of the European Court of Human Rights. There is one doctrine which applies both in the United States and in the European Court of Human Rights, which is called the doctrine of political question. Political question doctrine, especially in the United States, in Europe, in French law, it's called acte de gouvernement, is a situation in which the courts, this would not be true of the European Court of Human Rights, the courts do not want to get involved with questions which entail national security. They don't want to get involved sometimes with questions which entail, which concern national defense. And it is possible, for example, that the American Supreme Court, if it came to that, would employ that doctrine. As I said, it's called the doctrine of political question doctrine. In the European Court of Human Rights, this doctrine was used under French name of acte de gouvernement, which is a very feeble doctrine, and I don't think it would be used here. Then the question is, of course, whether the citizen would succeed in front of the European Court of Human Rights, but more than anything else, I would like to say that the citizen, would be more likely to be successful in any real sense of the word before the domestic constitutional courts, typically the German, the Italian constitutional court, not so much the French Conseil Constitutionnel or the English Supreme Court, that does not have the power to strike down a particular law or particular practice, probably based on some kind of law which is unconstitutional. In other words, I would think that in principle this question is more a question of constitutionality of national law rather than constitutionality in terms of the European conventionality, so to say, of the European Convention of Human Rights. Moreover, we don't have the power to strike down the law on which this kind of unacceptable massive surveillance is based, whereas national courts, of course, vis-a-vis particular agencies of the national state would have that power to do it. When it comes to particular cases of electronic surveillance, we don't have too many in the European Court, and mostly they are connected, just like in American law, with the criminal procedure. In other words, the question would be whether the evidence so collected vis-à-vis a particular suspect or defendant in a criminal case would be admissible or not especially rich in this respect is the American constitutional law, which I used to have taught, so I know a little bit about it, where the right to privacy, of course, is specifically connected with the admissibility of evidence in criminal procedure. And that, well, I should say perhaps to conclude, a few words about the right to privacy. In the European connection, we have the so-called Persönlichkeitsrechten in German law, or we have the droit de personnalité in French law, which are protective of the individual's privacy. No such thing exists in the United Kingdom, where I taught on this, well, lectured on these questions recently. And no such thing exists, of course, in the United States. The article by Justice Brandeis on privacy is a very important piece of legal writing, but when it comes to specific protection of individual privacy, this cannot compare with the elaborate system of privacy protection under the Persönlichkeitsrechten, the rights of personality. This would be my opening remarks. I'm ready for any questions if you so want, sir.
Thank you very much, Judge Zupančič, and thank you for being so brief. It gives us a chance to ask more questions. Of course, we have an Article 8 case which we're discussing in our next session, so there's some overlap there too, which we can bring into discussion. I'm going to start with our shadow rapporteurs, and we're going to ask individual questions and then put those individual questions to you for individual answer, and then go to the rest of our members. First of all, from Mr. Axel Voss of the EPP group. Mr. Voss, your question.
Vielen Dank auch für Ihre... Achso, darf ich auf Deutsch sprechen? Ja. Vielen Dank auch für Ihre Darlegungen. Ich hoffe, es wird entsprechend übersetzt. Sie hatten als Feststellung gesagt, dass es mehr eine Frage des nationalen Rechts ist, wie man damit letztlich auch umgeht. Jetzt ist für mich nur die Frage, in einer globalisierten Welt, wo sich möglicherweise auch die Geheimdienste entsprechend globalisieren, was machen wir mit einer Umgehung solcher nationalen Rechte, wenn nämlich der eine Geheimdienst, weil er seine eigenen Leute nicht untersuchen darf, sich an den befreundeten anderen Geheimdienst wendet, der das wiederum darf und sich so die Informationen beschafft, würde ich als Umgehung dieser nationalen Vorgaben sehen. Eine zweite Frage wäre, das hatte ich auch eben schon einmal gestellt, ist für Sie alleine das Speichern von Daten schon eine Verletzung von Persönlichkeitsrechten oder ist es nachher lediglich die Analyse, die Verwendung dieser Daten? Und eine dritte Frage dazu, hatten Sie schon mal die Möglichkeit gehabt, mit einem Fall zu hantieren, wo es um Vorratsdatenspeicherung ging?
Thank you very much for the questions. Now, the storage of the data is just as problematic, as legally speaking, as the surveillance itself, because nobody has the right to infringe on the privacy of the individual and store data about him without his or her consent. That is clear. Then, could you repeat the second question?
Inwieweit für Sie das Speichern von Daten alleine schon eine Beeinträchtigung der Persönlichkeitsrechte sein könnte? Oder lediglich, oder was heißt lediglich, aber oder eben die Verwendung oder Analyse ist dann eine Beeinträchtigung oder das Speichern für sich alleine gesehen auch schon?
No, as I said, the storage alone is sufficient to constitute a violation. because nobody has the right to infringe on your privacy to the extent that they gather information on you which may or may not be used. However, in specific cases, especially as I said in the American constitutional law, in the specific cases, the problem comes to the surface when that data, these data, so to say, are used to, for example, convict a criminal suspect on whom this electronic surveillance has been centered, has been focused. Then as far as the national systems are concerned, as I said, national systems are, in a sense, accomplices of the foreign surveillance system insofar as they obtain and use those data that are obtained in an illegal fashion. Now, what is illegal in the United States may not be illegal, well, what is legal, I'm sorry, in the United States may not be illegal in Germany or in France or in Italy, etc. But in that respect, if the national security agencies are in cahoots, so to say, in connection with the foreign agency, the individual, when it comes to European Court of Human Rights, may start an action against the national agency, that is a particular state in which he or she is residing or in which he or she thinks has violated his rights. And then, of course, the national courts are going to be the first obliged to react in this particular fashion.
Judge Subhanchik, I think you didn't hear Mr. Voss's first and third question. Am I right? Is that correct?
Maybe I heard the third question. The first question I didn't understand, if you could repeat it.
Yeah. Axel, if you could repeat the first question.
And die erste Frage beschäftigte sich mit der Situation, dass man zwar, wenn Sie sagen, es ist mehr eine Frage des nationalen Rechts, dass im Rahmen der Globalisierung auch von Geheimdiensten natürlich durchaus auch der Austausch über Daten besteht, das, was der eine nicht machen darf, macht der andere und nimmt deshalb die Erkenntnisse des anderen sozusagen für sich dann.
That's right. No, I understand that. I thought I sort of responded to that to some extent already, insofar as the case which might come before the European Court of Human Rights must first exhaust all domestic remedies in Germany, for example. And that necessarily means that the German Constitutional Court would have to pronounce itself on this particular question. Necessarily, because the case cannot otherwise come to the European Court of Human Rights. European Court of Human Rights is a regional organization. And therefore, in a globalized world, if the problem comes from the United States, not from one of the member countries, the situation is completely different. You cannot sue the United States in front of the European Court of Human Rights because they are not signatory to the convention. There is a very complex doctrine concerning Article 1 of the Convention, which talks about the question of whether the effective control of a particular situation is such that it would involve the responsibility of the particular country. In other words, if the secret services of the United Kingdom collaborate with the NSA or any of the foreign countries in this respect, the passive legitimacy, as it's called, as the standing to be sued on the part of the national state, in that case, United Kingdom, would be given. In other words, it would be possible to sue United Kingdom insofar as it has collaborated with the American agency on the one hand. On the other hand, the national domestic remedies, all the legal means within the domestic system would have to be exhausted beforehand, before the case would ever come to the European Court of Human Rights, which in turn means that this case before it will ever come to the European Court of Human Rights will take years of domestic legislation, litigation before it can reach us in Strasbourg.
Okay, Judge Spanchik, I'm going to take the next question from Mrs. Intervelt, who's from the ALDE group.
Yes, thank you, Chair, and thank you, Judge, for your presentation. I have to say, and that's not you're not personally to blame for that, but I find this deeply depressing. If I weren't a politician, and anyone who isn't a lawyer, just a regular citizen, would feel citizens have no real legal protection, no real legal recourse, because even if officially such recourse would exist, it is such a legal jungle that it is impossible to find your way around it. And ironically, just this week, I will be in Luxembourg for a hearing of a council appeal case against me because I asked access to documents about, 6 years ago. Now, you know, I tend to be very tenacious, but, you know, if you're a regular citizen and you want to defend your rights, then, you know, basically you're lost. That's also what you're saying. What you said I found very shocking, you're probably right, that courts do not go near anything to do with national security. And that is, you know, I get that feeling too. And, well, you're shaking your head. I hope you're going to say I got it all wrong. But there is no effective legal protection for citizens' rights. Is that the conclusion?
Okay, Judge, there is no effective right. It's a rhetorical question. Okay, what's your answer to that?
I don't know whether it's a rhetorical question or not, but what I mentioned was the political question doctrine, which applies primarily to the United States. In other words, I said that if the United States, the courts were to tackle that problem, it might be that they would say that this is a question of national security and that therefore they will not touch it. This is not true in Europe. As I said, the Acte de Gouvernement doctrine in the European Court of Human Rights is a very feeble doctrine. Therefore, the court would tackle, of course, such a problem. But I must say that for anybody coming from a particular country, United Kingdom, etc., Ireland, whatever, he or she must exhaust domestic remedies. Because we are a court of last resort, there is something called subsidiary doctrine, and we only deal with these questions once they come to us. And they will, of course, if you have a very active legal profession, they will try to bring the case very soon and very fast before the courts. And then, of course, after the exhaustion of those domestic remedies, the court will end up in the European Court of Human Rights. But it will take a few years.
I have a question along those lines too, but I'm going to go to, I'll come back, we're doing well with time, so I shouldn't say that, that's just going to encourage everyone, but we're doing quite well with time, so we can keep coming back, but next we go to Jan Albrecht, for you judges from the Green Group.
Thank you very much, and thank you for being so open also on the situation when it comes to the application of the European Convention of Human Rights. I think that, I mean, our scope, what we are talking about here, is not only with regard to NSA activities and infringements by third states authorities. Our scope is also with regard to authorities here in the European Union and in the member states, of course, of the European Union, and therefore also in the member states of the conventions of the Council of Europe. And as you have signed, of course, there would be a binding situation to the convention, and it would be open to any citizen to get legal remedy in front of domestic courts and as last resort in Strasbourg. Now, there has been the one or another case already in Strasbourg on personal data on privacy in the past. One of it was the case MARPA versus UK, where it was said by the court, more or less a bit shortened, that an investigation purely into the blue, without having a suspicion vis-à-vis the subject, is not compatible with the right to privacy. And I would like to ask you how you stand to this judgment. Is that still applying? And would you feel personally also in your situation as a judge see that the collection and or analysis of metadata with regard to email blanketly of users would be anyhow justifiable under the right to privacy, or is that going beyond the proportionality written out also by your court?
It's going beyond any kind of proportionality, but what you refer to is the so-called doctrine of probable cause. In a criminal procedure situation, in order to be able to invade the privacy of the particular suspect, criminal defendant, future criminal defendant, in order to listen and electronically survey him, you have to have a reasonable suspicion or probable cause in order to be able to invade his privacy. Which means that, of course, in situations where there is no such suspicion, such invasion would for sure be unacceptable. In other words, one must distinguish situations where particular individuals are suspects in a particular criminal procedure context. And in this respect, the individual is a victim of surveillance if the probable cause against him does not obtain. If it does obtain, if it doesn't obtain, and the evidence is therefore thereafter admitted in a criminal trial, that evidence is may be excluded from, especially if you have a jury trial, the evidence may be excluded, or in other situations the courts will not be able to refer to it in their reasoning over the judgment. But that's a specific context of criminal procedure. Here we are not dealing with that. Here we are dealing with electronic surveillance on a massive scale, metadata, etc., etc., which have no probable cause and no reasonable suspicion, and therefore they are, would be a priori open to attack in the courts, and would be utterly unacceptable. However, what the national courts, let's say typically German constitutional court, can do is they can strike down the law, as I said before, on which such electronic surveillance is based in the country. European court cannot do that. European court can only give damages for the violation of the right to privacy. And those damages typically would have to be paid by the national state rather than anybody else.
Judge, can I ask Jan Albrecht to come back in, please? Jan.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you very much. I think that was clear. Now, my follow-up question to that would be, in most of these cases of mass surveillance, possible citizens, possible infringements to citizens are not visible or possibly to be proved by the concerned citizen of convention's member state. So how should I go to a domestic court if there's no opportunity for me as a citizen of any convention member state and prove that my rights are possibly infringed, or that my rights, that there are evidence for an infringement, if there's no transparency, or in opposition, rules on secrecy, obviously rules on secrecy, which we have not really voted on, I don't know, forbidding that. This is somehow a vicious circle where I would like to know your answer as a judge of the court of the last resort, how to deal with it if there is a loss of rule of law, a loss of fair trial of my right to a judge in a convention member state. Isn't there also, or shouldn't there also be a possibility to access the Strasbourg court, court jurisprudence? Thank you very much.
Yes, very interesting question. Your question concerns the active standing, as it's called in law, to sue in a situation where you cannot be certain, not positively certain, although it is probable, that you have been the victim of electronic surveillance, etc. This standing to sue, or it's called in legitimatio activa, is called in law, is possible when you have shown to the court, as you said, that you are the victim specifically of that electronic surveillance. But there are situations in our case law where the victim status was not apparent, was not in completely obvious, but under the particular law of the country, the person might at any moment become a, this is the so-called sodomy cases, might at any moment become a victim of prosecution in situations where the homosexual practices were proscribed by law. And therefore, sometimes it is not necessary that you are directly already affected by the practices which are not acceptable, I mean by electronic surveillance. It is enough that you show that you are probably the victim of that kind of surveillance because everybody else is. And that is a notorious fact so far, and therefore it is not necessary that you would show specifically that you are the victim.
Thank you very much, Judge, for coming back. I'm going to now go to the members if they have any questions. Do we have any questions, colleagues? No further questions. My question, in fact, Judge, is really I wanted to keep it for the next session. I know that Professor Korff also is dying to come in. And my question actually was, I'm from the UK, and my question was, in fact, about Article 10 and Article 8 and this court of last, this position of last resort. And it was actually a more philosophical question about how people are feeling that their domestic legal framework is not sufficient, and they want to see the ECHR as a court which protects freedom of expression. And we now have, as you know, I mean, I think perhaps if you answer this, I mean, this probably I want to keep this for the next session. We have an Article 8 case now, which is going to the court. And my question is how you perceive now the European Court of Human Rights in this position, because increasingly in the UK, people are not seeing remedies at domestic level. They just see a political deficit as well as a judicial deficit. They don't see the point of taking a case. They also see it as too expensive. Legal aid is not available. So we don't have the kind of jurisprudence developing. And I would like to know your opinion on this. And also you have this extraordinary situation where journalists who would not really want to defend the ECHR, and you know that there's a movement for us to leave the ECHR, but now suddenly this is becoming, people want to stay in it post-Leveson, as you probably noticed, which I think is a paradoxical position. I'm not going to make any other comments, but it would be interesting to know what you think of that situation, because I think we have a deficit occurring on national jurisprudence in our country. That's a question I really wanted to keep for other colleagues, but it would be interesting to know your point of view on this.
You have a deficit concerning what?
Domestic remedies in the UK. So, for example, as Mr. Albrecht said, if you want a domestic remedy in a member state like the UK, it's actually very difficult. You're not going to get legal aid. You're not going to be able to take a case very efficiently. The Article 8 case, which has been taken, of course, is a massive fundraising effort that's being taken by a number of organisations. And if you're the victim of surveillance in the UK, it's very difficult as an private individual to take such a case, and we've seen this illustrated during the Leveson inquiry. So I just wanted your opinion and what you think is now the perception of the European Court of Human Rights, which is now seen as a kind of saviour of freedom of expression all of a sudden, from some people who actually wanted us to leave the European Court of Human Rights. And as you know, there is a movement for the UK to leave.
Yes, well, this is a fundamental position of the European Court of Human Rights and of the Convention, that the subsidiary role of the European Court comes into play only after the domestic remedies have been exhausted. But to take a more cynical view of that, if you want, well, it's not really cynical, but it's a practical view of that, is that if the domestic remedies are not readily available, then it's so much easier to exhaust them. In other words, yes, you have to push the case through all the instances before you can come to the European Court of Human Rights, but you don't have to be successful. On the contrary, you must not be successful in order for the European Court to come into play. And therefore, I would not want to comment on this very delicate question of the adherence of the UK to the convention, etc., etc. But when it comes to privacy protection in the United States, in the United Kingdom, it is absolutely true that the droit de personnalité, the persönlichkeitsrechte, don't exist in the same sense. As I said, I gave a lecture in London on that about 3-4 months ago, and it became apparent during the discussion that they have read the Brandeis article, for example, which I mentioned before, but they don't have the domestic means, exactly as you say, to push the case and succeed in the domestic context. But then, all the more so, if they don't succeed, can they bring the case to the European Court of Human Rights?
Thank you very much, and thank you, Judge Spanchik, for your presence here today and for your presentation. It's very much appreciated. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. My pleasure.
Okay, and now we go on to our third speaker in this session.
Skip with Martin Shiner,
yep.
So I can
okay, so you can go to the slides. Okay, and this is the third session, or the third speaker, and this is covering EU law. And it's Professor Douwe KORFF, who's been Professor of International Law at London Metropolitan University since 2002, and he specialised in human rights and data protection. Professor KORFF is known to many of us, and he's going to fulfil this EU section, which is the big bit. So, without further ado, Professor KORFF.
This one on, I think. Yes, thank you very much, and thank you to the committee for inviting me here. It's a very important session, as I was indeed reminded, because many of the other sessions have dealt with perhaps more the political issues and the practical and technical issues. It is really important for the committee to move this to the legal level as well. I hope I can add a few points to Judge Zupančič's comments. In being a judge, he's perhaps more of an angel and can say a bit less than fools like me can rush in to say about the convention. I may perhaps even start right at the beginning with a comment on this exhaustion issue that Jan Albrecht picked up. It is settled case law in Strasbourg that if there is no effective remedy available, you do not have to exhaust the either non-available or not effective remedy. And indeed, if there is something called an administrative practice, you don't have to exhaust the domestic remedy. So there are definitely possibilities, and Nick Pickles will no doubt add more to that on that score. I was told that if I want to make kudos with this committee, I have to stick to my 10 minutes. Given that we got a bit of extra time, I might squeeze it a little bit. I have submitted...
That was the pre-meeting. I will
have to try. This is the long version, is it, that they've put up? I was hoping for the short version. But what I have given you is a note I wrote in August which deals with the issues in a sort of textual way. I have also submitted something called the EDRI 3 submission on surveillance, which I helped to draft, which deals with these issues perhaps in a more activist sort of way, as well as two sets of slides, the long version and the short version. And unfortunately, you have the long version in front of you, but I'll try and skip through it fairly quickly even so. Mostly because I don't want to tread on what other people have already said. So let me start very quickly. I've got a number of, as you can see, this is also an unfinalized version, but it doesn't matter. You can find everything in due course on the net. I'm going to talk about the ECHR requirements, the way the ECHR requirements are reflected in EU law, the general international data protection requirements in the EU is, of course, very important, and the international legal requirements, which Professor SCHEININ has covered, but I'll just add a few comments to it. And then I will come to the final, it's a preliminary issue in legal terms, but it's a very important one, I've left it to the end, and that is about the competence of the EU with regard to national security and national states, and I'm sure the committee will find that an important topic, and that's what I'll focus on. Very quickly, there is, in fact, a considerable amount of case law in Strasbourg on surveillance, going back to the class judgment, but in particular I would draw the attention of the committee to the Weber and Savaria judgment against Germany, and to compare that with Liberty and others against the UK. From that you can deduce quite a clear set of principles that states should adhere to in terms of the European Convention of Human Rights in conducting surveillance. I have summarized those, for those who want to have the paperwork there, on page 6 of the note that I submitted in August. So one-page summary, which I hope you will find useful. What I add there as well is that states have a positive obligation. Well, they have an obligation not to carry out improper surveillance to start with. They also have a positive obligation to prevent other states from spying on their citizens. And of course they shouldn't collude in illegal surveillance by third states either. And also to add to what Professor SCHEININ has also said, it is modern international law generally that states should comply with their international human rights requirements also when they're acting in relation to people outside their territory. And that has been very well established by the court. The court has said very clearly states should not be allowed to do things on the territory of other state parties that they are not allowed to do at home. That makes good common sense, and I think it's something to remember. There are also very clear procedural requirements in the European Convention on Human Rights. There must be very strict control of surveillance. There must be strict time limits. There must be strict purpose limitation spelled out in the law, and all that is not in existence in the systems that we have seen in the United Kingdom. And Eric Pickles will no doubt be able to, and Nick Pickles will be able to say more about it. I'm giving you the reference to the case that he will present later on. This is the bit about the extraterritorial application. I've already mentioned that. And of course, the European Convention of Human Rights is in substance very similar to the Charter of Fundamental Rights. The Charter of Fundamental Rights, if anything, takes it slightly forward. It has a specific sui generis right of data protection, so it underlines the importance of data protection in EU law. I think when you look at the case law of the court, there's no case law of the court on the national security exemption. I'll come to that later. But if you look at the Sabam ruling, the court was very critical of generalized monitoring of people, even if it's for a legitimate aim, and it was very strict in applying the proportionality system. And I would expect the court in Luxembourg to apply those same principles if a case with regard to national security surveillance came before it. Here you have the judgment in Sabam on that slide. I hope everybody here is aware of the general data protection principles, and I don't have to spell them out. Processing of data has to be fair, it has to be transparent, it has to serve a lawful purpose, it has to have a proper legal basis, there must be restrictions on transported data flows, people must be given rights. We all know those principles. All I can say is the kind of surveillance that we now know has taken place from the United Kingdom in particular, but it looks like there are other European states that have not behaved well either, is utterly incompatible with the most fundamental data protection principles in Europe. Absolutely, utterly, fundamentally in conflict with the most basic European human rights and data protection principles. And I'd put that a bit clearer in the next in the next slide, with reference, by the way, to an interesting study on the views of the different national courts on data retention. And I think it's important to look at that. If data retention is dubious, and I find it extremely dubious, then mass surveillance and data mining is beyond the pale. Finally, on that data protection issue, something, this is, I'm afraid, a hobby horse of mine, but when you do data mining on the basis of keyword searches, with artificial intelligence being used to make computers learn to come up with more and more sophisticated outcomes of those searches, you're effectively instituting profiling. Profiles, I've written it in other contexts, are dangerous, inherently dangerous by themselves, especially if you're looking for very rare phenomena like terrorists, let alone potential terrorists, or people who may become terrorists. You're inevitably going to end up with massive amounts of false negatives and false positives that are going to destroy the lives of many people. It is something that really should be cautioned against in the context of the general data protection regulation, but also in this particular context of data mining for national security purposes. I've given an example here from the Schleswig-Holstein law on national security monitoring, just to show one example of how you can have laws that are restrictive and that are, certainly on the face of it, human rights compliant. And if what you can see here is very clear, a clear definition of the purpose, what can be, for what purposes surveillance can be used. And I'll come back to that in a minute when I talk about the national security exemption. A clear requirement that activities must be targeted, and I think Jan Albrecht again asked a question about that. There have to be specific evidence for specific targets. The final point, it has to be based on real, factual, individualized evidence. Suspicion evidence. It doesn't, of course, have to be sufficient to convict, but sufficient evidence to target individuals rather than broad sweeping surveillance of everybody just in case somebody might possibly in the future become a terrorist or become some kind of subversive in some other way. That is the opposite of the rule of law. Finally, just to confirm everything that Martin already said, these principles that are applied in Europe are identical in most respects to the ones that are applied by the Human Rights Committee under the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. The need for a clear and a specific foreseeable law, of course, published law, no secret courts, the need for clear legitimate aim, the clear for necessity and for proportionality. On those principles, the UN principles and the European principles are identical. Equally on the point that non-nationals should be given equal protection to nationals. Equally on the question that actions outside a state's territory are equally subject to the data, the human rights requirements of the ICCPR or the European Convention of Human Rights. The United States is a party to the ICCPR. I totally agree with Martin Scheininin that it would be essential to bring an interstate case in this global threat to everybody's fundamental rights in an interconnected new world. And by the way, if states act outside their territory, that also violates the sovereignty of those other territories. And that's a principle that goes back hundreds of years, most clearly stated in the Lotus case by the Permanent Court for International Justice in 1927. And I think I've got the quote here. I haven't got the actual quote, but it's the first and most holy principle of international law is that you do not exercise your power on the territory of, or dare I say it, with regard to the citizens of another state. So states also act in violation of general principles of public international law, and Vivian Redding, by the way, confirmed that as well. In that context, one particular issue, there is a proposal in Strasbourg that a new additional protocol be added to the Cybercrime Convention that would legalize this cross-border gathering of evidence by law enforcement and possibly also national security agencies. Peter Hustings has said before this very committee, everything must be done to stop that additional protocol, and I totally and fully endorse him in that view. Now let me come to the point that I really wanted to come to. I hope I have quickly enough gone over everybody else's ground, and that is the national security exemption in the treaties. If you read the Article 4.2, it very simply says national security remains the sole responsibility of each member state. If you read that on its face, it says this is totally for the states to sort out, no competence whatsoever for the political organs, the Charter doesn't apply because it's EU law, and the Court of Justice has no competence. That is a wild overstatement of the legal position, and I really think it's important for the committee to realise that. The first question is that there are a whole range of competences within EU law on matters like internal security, and then I'm talking about the internal security of the Union. Under the common foreign security policy, the Union also have competences in relation to international peace and security. And of course, there are massive competences within justice and home affairs in relation to terrorism and serious crime. You cannot separate those other matters from national security of the individual member states. And it is a matter of general treaty law, I'm quoting the Vienna Convention on the Law of Treaties, that states may not act in a way that undermines their treaty obligations. What that means is that the United Kingdom cannot act in relation to national security matters in a way that undermines the matters that are within EU competence in relation to internal security and in relation to international security and in relation to the fight against terrorism and serious organized crime. The UK and other states that spy on citizens of other countries have a duty to act in relation to their national security interests in a manner that is compatible with their obligations under the treaties generally. And indeed, that goes also in with regard to anything that might affect the fundamental rights and freedoms, including the typical European freedoms under the treaties more generally. That's one issue. So there is a competence of the committee and of the EU generally to check whether the actions by the United Kingdom in particular are compatible with its obligations under the treaties in these other fields. And there was, of course, also the fundamental question of what constitutes national security. Now, we have seen that the United States in particular, under FISA, has an extremely broad definition of what the NSA can do. It's not limited to national security, as anybody can reasonably understand it. They can hoover up any data that might in any way be useful or relevant or of interest in relation to the United States international relations. It can include commercial spying, it can include political spying on totally non-violent political groups such as Big Brother Watch or ORG or any of the other groups that I work with, but also environmental groups or gay rights groups or anything they fancy. The United Kingdom's definition is also deficient. In fact, there is no definition of national security in UK law. The courts have refused to entertain it all. They said it's much broader than it used to be. It used to be a threat to the independence and the existence of the state. But now it can also include pandemics, environmental threats, and there has even been a case in which the United Kingdom refused to continue a case, a very serious bribery case in the UK courts, because it threatened the good relations with the country where the bribery took place. And it said that too, having good relations with bad countries is also part of national security. So the concept of national security in UK law is much too wide. Professor SCHEININ, in some of his submissions, has given some interesting definitions in the UN instruments. I want to mention the Johannesburg principles, which were drafted by Article 19, but they have been endorsed by a range of political bodies, I think including at the Council of Europe and at the UN. And it has a very restrictive definition, as you can see here, of national security. It is to protect the country's existence or its territorial integrity against the use or threat of force, or its capacity to respond to the threat or use of force. It is not legitimate to use national security powers to protect the government from embarrassment or exposure of wrongdoing, or to conceal information about the functioning of its institutions, and I might add, or to get some advantage in diplomatic negotiations or to give advantage to companies from that country. It is important to have a narrow definition. Since this term, national security, is used in Article 4.2 of the Treaty on European Union, it is a legal concept within EU law. And the Court of Justice in Luxembourg, even if it cannot have that much, I'll come to that in a second, that much jurisdiction about states' action in that field, does have the right to interpret this legal term in a way that is compatible with the treaties and with fundamental rights. And I would urge this committee to look at that. These are these broad definitions elsewhere. So let me come to my general conclusions about EU competence. I believe that the EU institutions are legally allowed to assess within their own competences whether the UK surveillance programmes and its data exchanges and its cooperation with the USA are limited to the protection of national security in the sense in which that term must be understood in international and EU law. It's a legal question. Even if the UK's actions are limited to national security as properly understood, there is still the question, as I said, of whether those actions don't undermine the competences of the EU, either joint competences or sole competences of the EU, in relation to internal security, international security, or the fight against terrorism and serious crime. Of course, if this committee or the court were to find that the actions of the United Kingdom and other states were not limited to national security as properly understood, then that would not be covered by the exemption in Article 4.2, and that means that those extra exemption activities would be fully within the competences of this committee and of the EU to assess. And that, of course, includes in particular whether it's compatible with data protection rights and principles. And as far as the US concerned, this committee and the EU generally has the competence to check whether the USA is acting in contravention of the EU's data protection rules in any activity carried out in the EU. And we know that EU data protection rules have applied to non-EU-based controllers in certain respects. And, of course, especially with regard to the safe harbour and the PNR and SWIFT agreements, I can say, I believe anybody can say, and certainly anybody who heard Connolly's presentation to this committee, the safe harbour is the most unsafe harbour you could possibly wish to steer your ship into. I think I will leave it at this. I hope I've more or less kept my time. I just want to say at the end, I agree with Peter Hustink, my compatriot, that we are facing an existential challenge to our fundamental rights and liberty. This is not some kind of trivial issue. We are talking about in an interconnected age of something that touches the very core, Professor SCHEININ said it as well, the very core of our right of autonomy in a free and democratic society. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor KORFF. I think we have declared safe harbour unsafe on this committee. That's one thing we've done. Your presentation is being uploaded, the full presentation is being uploaded on the LIBE website. I also should mention, I've had a couple of messages from some of our members who have very compelling reasons for not being here and wanted to be here and wanted me to mention to all the speakers that they are very saddened that they couldn't be here and they wanted to send their appreciation for your presentations. Can we now just open the floor to, first of all, to Jan Albrecht for his first question?
Yeah, thank you very much, and thank you also for outlining the cases in detail, because I think that obviously there is a clear infringement to the convention's text or legal framework. And my question, therefore, would be, as you also at the beginning lined out the way how this can be addressed for individuals, do you see also a possibility for member states and institutions to point out infringements or to go to Strasbourg Court? If yes, I would be very interested in listening about that. And also, if you see that, for example, in the Council of Europe, there's also in some way a need for political debate on the massive infringement, obviously, of the framework of the Council of Europe and its treaties, and in which way governments carrying these treaties should care about these laws to be enforced. So also from an international law perspective, what are the possibilities for diplomacy on that with regard to the infringements of this convention?
Do you want to answer that one first, and then I'll go. Then I'll go on next to Mrs.
Okay. Yeah, that's a good broad issue. Let me start just going back a little bit again with what Judge Zupančič said about the court in Strasbourg not being able to change, to order the changes of law the way the German Constitutional Court can suspend parts of law. That is a bit too easy to put it like that. In many, many countries in Europe, the laws have changed because of judgments in Strasbourg and have had to be changed. And after all, there is an implementation mechanism of the judgments in Strasbourg through the Committee of Ministers, slightly odd, but that has actually improved over the years. So if there is a finding in Strasbourg that a particular activity of a state violates the convention, then the state is obliged to take remedial action. And if the activity is squarely based on its national law, it will have to change the law. And otherwise, it won't come off the agenda of the Committee of Ministers. So I do think there are possibilities there. Within Europe, the possibility of having some issues looked at in Luxembourg is perhaps more complex than the ones of actually getting things to Strasbourg. Because since in many respects, there are no adequate remedies available, certainly with regard to what we've now learned about GCHQ in the UK. I think it is obvious that the supervisory mechanisms in the UK were inadequate because they didn't stop this obvious breach of the convention. So there is no effective remedy, and therefore you can go straight to Strasbourg, and therefore Strasbourg could deal with this fairly quickly, and it could be before the Committee of Ministers fairly quickly. On top of that, the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe has called, I think it's been referred to the Legal Affairs Committee, for an Article 52 inquiry by the Secretary General, which could be wider and could involve other states as well. I believe it is very useful, would be very useful to have such an inquiry. I would hope that the Council of Europe Commissioner for Human Rights would use his power to intervene in such a case, which he's never done. And that would, I think, create an enormous amount of momentum at the Strasbourg level for trying to come up with ways of reconciling legitimate interests of the state in protecting its national security with its fundamental requirements under the convention. Something on the lines of the Schleswig-Holstein law that I've pointed out, just an example, but it is so much better to read what it says there. Clear factual evidence, targeted surveillance, good supervisory mechanisms, good parliamentary control. All those elements are there. And I would hope that these kind of measures would do this. I also fully endorse Professor Scheinin's call for an interstate case under the ICCPR. I think that the one thing would be to look for the right kind of state. One problem, if you want a bit of advice there, many years ago, I looked at the interstate complaints against Turkey over massive torture and other human rights violations. And it was hugely problematic that there were something like 5 or 7 states involved in the interstate case. It might be better to have one country bringing the interstate case with the other countries taking a bit of a backseat rather than having three or four or five ministries, foreign ministries involved in a complex case like that. So that would be one tip. But I would very much endorse the ICCPR route, and that does not stand in the way of the interstate case in the UK as well, of course. Plus Article 52 inquiry by the Secretary General of the Council of Europe, and exploring the possibilities of some Luxembourg action, but I think you know better than I do there how complex that is.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Sippel. Oh, sorry, Ariane, you want to come back quickly?
I don't want to take the other's time, okay. But as we are a little cozy around, I think it should be possible. Just because I have something in my mind which is also linked to the question of international law, and as you are a very well-known international law expert, I would like to ask it to you. In my view, we have to deal also with attacks on sovereignty of states. Obviously, there was a huge attack by British authorities on the sovereignty of Belgium. Obviously, there are other attacks going on also, United States, vis-a-vis European states or other states. I don't know, but my impression is that we are dealing with the erosion of sovereignty, and I cannot remember any other case of that extent in or infringements, international sovereignty being accepted by the particular cases in that way. So my question would be if you would share that view. And the second question is, if we talk about international law, if states do so, then it becomes accepted. So this will be somehow the international law of the future, and with regard to the activity of some states in our global society which are not following the basis of rule of law and democracy as OECD countries or Council of Europe countries are doing, what do you think this will have an impact for the international law environment which we have built as democratic states for the last decades? Thank you very much.
There might be possibilities to take a case to the International Court of Justice in The Hague, of course, on a pure sovereignty basis. But of course, you generally need the consensus of both states concerned. One positive note, if enough states object to this kind of practice, then you will not create customary international law. So I would hope an awful lot of states make clear that they are not happy about this practice, and then you will stop the creation of a customary norm on the basis of what some rogue states, as I almost call them, are now up to in this respect.
But what if not? That's
well,
the question.
One thing is, since the Second World War, before the Second World War, secret services did whatever they like anyway. Even the existence wasn't given free. Since the Second World War, there have apparently, and there have been the Echelon inquiry of Parliament a few years ago, 10 years ago already, secret services, national security agencies, have never properly been brought within the rule of law. I think that is the really broadest background that you have here. That, within the Cold War, that was broadly accepted because they only dealt with spies and these things in the dark outer edges of society anyway. With terrorism, national security, secret surveillance issues have started to permeate into ordinary lives. The difference between fighting crime and fighting threats against the state are being blurred. That's one of the greatest dangers that is brought about by terrorism, which is the anti-terrorist reaction of bringing the secret surveillance state into being, into the ordinary parts of life. I think if you want to really go back to base, all the treaties and all the international agreements that are in place on the basis of which all this globalization Mr. Voss mentioned it, is taking place, this cooperation between intelligence agencies. That must be reviewed. And I believe you have, of course, the Five Eyes, you have the UK-USA treaty, which is extended to the other English-speaking countries. You have NATO treaties. I have not seen them. I know that big parts of them are secret. There are treaties between, I think, even Germany and other states that nobody knows the details of. I think in a state under the rule of law, there should be no such thing as secret treaties. Everything must be based on the very least on public, foreseeable, clear rules that have democratic endorsement in parliaments. And we can talk about where the limits lie, but we have for too long lived in a situation where nobody even tried to draw the limits. I think that's what Hustings was saying, is that it's time to draw the line.
Mrs. Sippel.
Ja, vielen Dank. Wir haben ja diese Debatte begonnen angesichts von massiven Datensammlungen der USA und wir haben heute gehört, dass diese Sammlungen sehr wohl gegen internationale Vereinbarungen verstoßen, unsere Mitgliedstaaten sich aber nicht dagegen wehren. Und Sie haben eben darauf hingewiesen, dass mindestens auf dem Papier die Situation in Europa besser ist. Erste Frage, ist sie nur auf dem Papier besser und ist das der Grund, warum unsere Mitgliedstaaten keine Beschwerde einlegen? Weil dann könnten ja auch eigene Fehler auffallen. Zweitens, die Definition in den Verträgen zur nationalen Sicherheit als alleinige Verantwortung der Mitgliedstaaten. Ich habe mich da schon immer drüber gewundert, weil nationale Sicherheit, dazu gehört ja nach Aussage unserer Mitgliedstaaten auch der Kampf gegen den Terrorismus. Und zum Kampf gegen den Terrorismus arbeiten Staaten und Geheimdienste ja durchaus zusammen. Sie tauschen Informationen aus. Von daher würde ich erwarten und würde gerne Ihre Stellungnahme dazu hören, dass hier sehr wohl auch ein europäischer Aspekt durchaus enthalten ist in der Frage der nationalen Sicherheit. Und eine letzte Frage. Ja, es gibt in mindestens einigen Mitgliedstaaten Kontrollgremien, Mechanismen, die aber auch nicht immer gut funktionieren. Frage, mindestens dann, wenn ich eine europäische Zuständigkeit auch für nationale Sicherheit feststelle, habe ich dann auch die Möglichkeit, die Mitgliedstaaten, da wo Erkenntnisse vorliegen, aufzufordern, ihre Regeln der Transparenz und Verhältnismäßigkeit, was auch die Arbeit der Geheimdienste angeht, zu verbessern?
Ja, auf die
Professor Korff, sorry to finish the translation. Yeah. Professor Korff, could I just add one question for me and
please,
then ask you to answer the...
I will. Gladly.
Sorry, I'll add a question and then ask you just to do a final conclusion.
Yep.
I just wanted to ask you, to depart from the question I was going to ask you, about what you said about the national security exemption, and also to pick up on what... Jan Albrecht was saying about the Belgacom case again. One of the big difficulties we face in this inquiry, one of the many difficulties, is this whole issue. We had this ad hoc hearing on, obviously, Belgacom, one member state allegedly spying on another member state. Now, if in the post-war situation you don't have complete oversight of intelligence activities and you have complete denials that anything is happening, and yet in the treaties it also says that, you know, as you said, I think you said it's a wild overstatement to say that there's a national security exemption. I mean, how do you find your way through this? I mean, in the UK example, for example, there's an unwritten constitution. So the idea that you're ever going to have a statement of this is what it says constitutionally on secret services is going to be a very difficult position to get to. But what, you know, how do you map your way through this situation where you have allegations from one member state to another within the EU context, and then, you know, you're left with a situation where serious allegations are made, but you can hide within the context of the national, first of all, the national security exemption, and then you can hide, of course, with just general, it's a general allegation. And yet both are EU member states. I mean, it's a very difficult one for EU citizens to understand. It's a difficult one for us within an EU inquiry to understand. And you say it's a wild overstatement because we're also dealing with Europol and so many internal security ad hoc situations. So it's an interesting point.
I will try and deal with all the questions. Ich werde erstmal versuchen, Ihre Fragen zu beantworten. Sie sagen da, das war interessant, vor einigen Monaten haben die Amerikaner gesagt, warum werden wir immer beschuldigt, dass es hier bei uns so schlecht ist, bei euch in Europa ist es eigentlich noch schlimmer. Ne? Und ich weiß jetzt eigentlich, warum die das sagten. Die wussten da schon einiges, was wir nicht gewusst haben. Also das ist an sich schon interessant. Es ist natürlich wahr, dass es in Europa auf Papier besser ist. Wir haben eine Menschenrechtskonvention und die trifft zu. Da gibt es keine Ausnahme für nationale Sicherheit. Ne? Also die soll zutreffen. Da ist natürlich noch die Frage, ja, was passiert dann, wenn da nicht eingehalten wird? Na ja, gut, dann haben wir die Gerichtshöfe in jedem Staat, die sollten das aufrecht behalten, entweder unter der nationalen Verfassung oder unter der Menschenrechtskonvention. Und wenn das noch nicht gelingt, kann man nach Straßburg. Von mich aus, die Prinzipien sind ziemlich klar. Die sind nicht so schlecht, so schlimm anzuwenden von Gerichtshofen. Das sollte Richter schon können. So schlimm ist das nicht. Also da glaube ich, und die Tatsache, dass in den Vereinigten Staaten die Verfassung, der First and the Fourth Amendment, nicht anzuwenden sind auf Nichtbürger von Vereinigten Staaten, das ist ein fundamentaler Fehler im internationalen Menschenrechtsrecht. Das muss sich abändern. In dem Sinne ist das amerikanische System wirklich viel schlechter als bei uns. Aber die Praxis, darum geht es dann hier zum Zweiten. Jetzt haben wir die Möglichkeit, wo wir wissen, was alles passiert ist, jetzt haben wir die Möglichkeit, um erst auch mal die Tatsachen rauszukriegen. Da hat natürlich der Vorsitzende hier auch eine Frage, wie bekriegt man die? Naja, Sie haben schon ziemlich viel gehört. Duncan Campbell hat schon ziemlich viel gesagt und das schon ziemlich viel ist unterzwischen bekannt geworden. Terrorismus, ja, eben, da gibt es eben, in Sache Terrorismus gibt es EU-Kompetenz, zweifellos. Dann kann man nicht sagen, wir haben hier eine National Security Sache und da muss die EU rausbleiben. Das ist gerade, was ich sagte. Und ich glaube, da muss es die Möglichkeit geben, dass man das Gerichtshof in Luxemburg auch fragt, wie weit kann ein Staat gehen in seinen Maßnahmen gegen nationale Sicherheit, die zugleich auch mit Terrorismus zu tun haben, vor dem der EU Kompetenzen hat. Also das muss geklärt werden. Endgültig kann das nur vom Gerichtshof in Luxemburg geklärt werden. Und drittens, das war eigentlich das Gleiche über die EU-Kompetenz. Ich glaube, die EU hat Kompetenzen und die Abgrenzung der verschiedenen Kompetenzen ist nun einmal ganz genau eine juristische Frage. Dafür hat man das Gerichtshof nun einmal. And now, back to the chairman's question. How to deal with the question that you have these claims for a national security exemption by one state, one EU member state, that affects the fundamental rights of citizens in another EU member state. I think that is the hot political issue that this committee is facing. And I don't think you can duck that issue. We will have to come up with both a political and a legal answer to dealing with this. In a situation where terrorism does threaten many issues in the modern society, in which it is felt that the EU has to work together to try and protect the citizens against terrorism and at the same time the fundamental rights of citizens from excessive anti-terrorist measures. In such a situation, the national security exemption must be minimized. It can only be minimal. Of course, states must have a certain amount of sovereignty. I wouldn't want the EU to dictate operational details. But setting out the basic principles is not too difficult. I keep on repeating it. If they can do it in the national security law of Schleswig-Holstein, which is a tiny little place, quite decently, then it shouldn't be impossible to do something similar at EU and at Council of Europe level. The Cybercrime Convention would be an interesting angle to look at as well. States can't have it both ways. They can't say we are in a globalized, interconnected world. We have to work together to fight all these terrible things. And then at the same time say, but I don't want to be criticized when I take action in national security because that is my holy little island where nobody is allowed to look. I'm afraid that world is over.
Thank you very much for your presentation, and thank you to three of our speakers, Martin Schenin, Bostjan Zupančič, and you, Professor. I think now we can, if we change our top table, I think we can go straight on to the next session. Thank you to all of you.
Thank you.
I'll just give it to you.
He just went out in a minute. Okay. Just suspend 2 minutes, please.
Colleagues, there's going to be a suspension for 2 minutes while our speakers come.
Okay, guys, have the next.
Colleagues, we're going to move to our second session. As I said at the beginning, we're going to focus now on the pending court cases, which have been brought in various courts since the allegations about surveillance programmes were made. We've got two particular court cases which are going to be presented today, and I propose that we hear first from our three speakers and then we move to the normal question and answer session. We begin first with the case brought in Paris against X, and I welcome Dominique Guibert, Vice President of the Ligue des Droits de l'Homme. And Mr. Guibert, you have the floor.
Est-ce que je peux me permettre de faire quatre réflexions au sujet de ce que nous avons entendu précédemment, qui vont introduire ensuite ce que j'ai à dire. Ma première réflexion, elle est sur le rapport entre sécurité et liberté. Il ne faudrait pas qu'au nom de la difficulté de la justiciabilité des faits, nous tombions beaucoup plus du côté de la sécurité que de la liberté. En d'autres termes, ceux qui, la plupart du temps, avancent la difficulté de rendre justiciables ces faits sont souvent ceux qui pensent que la sécurité prime sur la liberté. Et je crains que dans ces cas-là, l'équilibre ne soit rompu. Ma deuxième réflexion, c'est que tout à l'heure, nous avons bien dit que le quatrième amendement de la Constitution des États-Unis interdisait le type de surveillance auquel les citoyens pourraient être soumis. Et on a dit, oui, mais ce n'est pas possible pour les autres. Et, or, en droit, ce n'est pas parce qu'une faute existe quelque part qu'elle peut être récupérée par une autre faute. En d'autres termes, ce n'est pas parce que c'est illégal aux États-Unis que ça doit devenir légal ailleurs. Ma troisième réflexion, elle tient sur la notion du secret. Nous avons constaté que même quand les autorités américaines disent que le Congrès et la Cour suprême supervisent ces questions de contrôle des communications ou autres, tout ça restait dans le secret. Or, le secret, ça n'est pas démocratique. Le secret ne peut pas être contrôlé par les citoyens, et ça me permet de rappeler la fondation de la Ligue des droits de l'homme française, mon organisation, en 1898, au moment de l'affaire Dreyfus, où ce qui était répondu aux avocats qui demandaient la publication des pièces qui permettaient de condamner le capitaine Dreyfus, répondait « la question ne sera pas posée ». Et ma quatrième réflexion, elle est sur la notion de sécurité. La sécurité intérieure est devenue maintenant étendue à la totalité de la sécurité. La sécurité intérieure, c'est aussi la sécurité extérieure. C'est ce qui permet de relier toutes ces questions de contrôle des citoyens, de contrôle des frontières, à tout ce qui fait qu'aujourd'hui, le mot emblématique, c'est forteresse. Et forteresse, ça m'oblige à rappeler que l'actualité, elle est tragique. C'est celle de la forteresse et c'est celle de Lampedusa. J'en viens maintenant à ce que je voulais vous présenter, à savoir la plainte, comme l'a dit le Président, comme la plainte que nous avons déposée devant le parquet de Paris. Donc la FIDH, Fédération internationale des droits de l'homme, et la LDH, Ligue française des droits de l'homme, ont saisi le 11 juillet 2013 le procureur de la République près le tribunal de grande instance de Paris d'une plainte contre X en raison des faits révélés par Edward Snowden. Agissant tant en raison de leur objet social, qui les conduit à faire sanctionner les atteintes aux libertés individuelles en matière de traitement informatisé, qu'à titre personnel, la FIDH et la LDH ont déposé plainte sur le fondement des articles du Code pénal qui sanctionnent l'accès frauduleux à un système informatisé, la collecte de données à caractère personnel par un moyen frauduleux, l'atteinte volontaire à la vie privée et l'utilisation et la conservation d'enregistrements et de documents obtenus par l'atteinte à la vie privée. Les révélations faites dans la presse par Snowden ont permis de dévoiler l'existence du programme américain nommé PRISM. Sous couvert de la lutte contre le terrorisme et la criminalité organisée, ce système d'interception des données privées, qui concerne tout autant les citoyens américains que les associations et individus étrangers, a permis à la NSA et au FBI de collecter des données matérielles hébergées par les serveurs des sociétés agissant sur le net. L'essence même de ce système donnant lieu à la surveillance d'un demi-milliard de communications par mois est, notamment au travers de mots-clés, d'appréhender non seulement l'origine d'un message privé, mais aussi son destinataire, ainsi que son contenu, quel que soit le moyen technique utilisé pour la transmission de ce message. Cette intrusion sans contrôle dans la vie de chacun constitue un danger pour les libertés individuelles qui doit être enrayé sous peine de mettre en cause gravement l'état de droit. La FIDH et la LDH saisissent donc la justice française afin qu'une information judiciaire portant sur les faits soit ouverte. Il convient de dire que le parquet a jugé que cette plainte était recevable. Nous attendons avec intérêt les procédures d'instruction concernant des entités dont la puissance pouvait apparaître comme parfaitement protectrice et dissuasive. La FIDH et la LDH ont considéré que puissance des unes n'équivalait pas à impuissance des autres et que ce combat méritait d'être mené. L'argumentation que nous avons présentée a consisté à rappeler l'existence pénale des infractions sur lesquelles se fondait, établir la matérialité des faits, définir ensuite les raisons des associations à se porter en justice, rappeler les compétences à juger des juridictions françaises et enfin à détailler les infractions commises justiciables des articles du Code pénal. Je suivrai ce plan pour présenter mon propos. Premièrement, sur la matérialité des faits. Les documents recueillis ont été classés secret défense et révèlent que la NSA et le FBI disposent d'un accès direct aux serveurs de 9 sociétés américaines exerçant dans le domaine de l'Internet, soit Microsoft depuis 2007, Yahoo depuis 2008, Google, Paltak et Facebook depuis 2009, YouTube et Skype depuis 2010, AOL depuis 2011 et enfin Apple depuis 2012. Le programme PRISM leur permet de collecter des données matérielles hébergées par les serveurs de ces sociétés, incluant notamment les historiques de recherche et de connexion effectuées sur le net, le contenu des emails, de communications audio et vidéo, des fichiers photos, des transferts de documents, ainsi que le contenu de conversations en ligne. Cette collecte de données s'opère sur le trafic d'informations effectué vers l'étranger et directement sur les serveurs des sociétés concernées. Il s'agit d'une surveillance électronique de masse, telle que l'explique Edward Snowden, je cite, « La NSA a construit une infrastructure qui lui permet d'intercepter pratiquement tout. » Il précise pour ailleurs, je cite encore, « Mais d'une manière générale, la réalité est la suivante. Si la NSA, le FBI, la CIA, le DIA et d'autres veulent interroger des bases de données brutes de renseignements électroniques, ils peuvent entrer et obtenir ce qu'ils veulent. Numéro de téléphone, mail, identifiant, numéro unique d'un téléphone portable, ce qu'on appelle le numéro mail, tout ça c'est pareil. Les restrictions portées à cet accès sont de nature politique et non technique, elles peuvent changer à tout moment. Ainsi, à raison d'un demi-milliard de communications privées surveillées par mois, selon les documents recueillis, la NSA a déjà collecté plus de 97 milliards d'informations en mars 2013. À cet égard, les sociétés susvisées ont formellement démenti non seulement avoir eu connaissance de ce programme, mais aussi avoir fourni un accès à leurs serveurs. À titre d'exemple, Steve Dowling, porte-parole d'Apple, soutient n'avoir jamais entendu parler de PRISM ou fourni aux agences du gouvernement un accès direct aux serveurs de la société. Pourtant, l'administration américaine affirme que le programme PRISM était déjà connu depuis 2006. À ce titre, le président Obama précise, je cite, « Ce que nous avons, ce sont deux programmes qui ont d'abord été autorisés par le Congrès et encore confirmés par le Congrès. De plus, les experts estiment que les sociétés concernées ne pouvaient ignorer la collecte des données matérielles hébergées sur leurs serveurs et auraient même été tenues de mettre en place les moyens techniques nécessaires pour permettre cette collecte. Le directeur des renseignements américains a quant à lui publié un communiqué dans lequel il affirme que, je cite, « Nous ne pouvons cibler des personnes étrangères sans des objectifs valides de renseignements étrangers ». Fin de la citation. Et ajoute que le programme PRISM est supervisé par un tribunal composé de 11 juges désignés par le président de la Cour suprême des États-Unis. Il résulte des éléments divulgués par la presse que les USA ont mis en place un système d'interception des données privées qui concerne tout autant les citoyens américains.
Excuse me, Monsieur Guibert, can you slow down a little bit for the interpreter?
Slowly.
Can you speak a little bit more slowly? Thank you.
Excusez-moi. Il résulte des éléments divulgués par la presse que les États-Unis ont mis en place un système d'interception des données privées qui concerne tout autant les citoyens américains que les associations et individus étrangers. L'essence même de ce système est notamment, au travers des mots-clés, d'appréhender non seulement l'origine d'un message, mais aussi son destinataire et son contenu. Ces faits conduisent à penser que sous couvert de lutte contre le terrorisme et la criminalité organisée, le gouvernement s'affranchit des règles de la territorialité pour créer un système de contrôle mondial hors de toute garantie légale et à leur seul profit. C'est dans ces circonstances que les associations que nous sommes se sont jugées contraintes de porter plainte auprès du procureur de la République, près du tribunal de grande instance de Paris, afin qu'il soit informé des faits subventionnés, susceptibles de recevoir une qualification pénale et pour qu'une information judiciaire ou tout le moins une enquête préliminaire soit diligentée afin de caractériser les infractions dénoncées. Deuxièmement, sur la recevabilité des plaintes et la constitution de partie civile. L'article 2, alinéa 1er du Code de procédure pénale dispose, je cite, « L'action civile en réparation du dommage causé par un crime, un délit ou une contravention appartient à tous ceux qui ont personnellement souffert du dommage directement causé par l'infraction. » En application de ce texte, et au visa notamment des articles 6 de la Convention européenne des droits de l'homme et 3 et 85 du Code de procédure pénale, la Cour de cassation, dans son arrêt du 9 novembre 2010, a dégagé le principe général selon lequel, je cite, « Pour qu'une constitution de partie civile soit recevable devant la juridiction d'instruction, il suffit que les circonstances sur lesquelles elle s'appuie permettent au juge d'admettre comme possible l'existence du préjudice allégué et la relation directe de celui-ci avec une infraction à la loi pénale. » En l'espèce, la Cour de cassation a accueilli, telle que l'avait fait le juge d'instruction, la constitution de partie civile d'une association de lutte contre la corruption pour le détournement de biens publics, abus de biens sociaux, blanchiment, complicité de ces délits, abus de confiance et recel, dès lors que, je cite, « les faits dénoncés en ce qui concerne la présence en France de biens pouvant provenir de détournement de fonds publics correspondent aux actions menées par cette association qui, engageant toutes ses ressources dans cette activité, subit dès lors un préjudice personnel, économique, directement causé par les infractions en cause, lesquelles portent atteinte aux intérêts collectifs qu'elle défend et constituent le fondement même de son action, qu'il a déclaré la constitution de partie civile recevable. La Chambre criminelle rappelle ainsi que les associations sont soumises au régime juridique de droit commun de la constitution de partie civile sans considération a priori de l'objet de l'association ni de la nature des poursuites. Les faits visés par la présente plainte portent sur plusieurs infractions en matière d'accès et de maintien dans un système de traitement automatisé de données et de protection des données personnelles détenues par certaines sociétés américaines. Dès lors, la FIDH et la LDH, particulièrement attentives et actives dans le domaine du respect de la vie privée et de la lutte contre les abus informatiques, subissent un préjudice personnel et direct causé par les infractions en cause, lesquelles portent atteinte aux intérêts collectifs qu'elles défendent et constituent le fondement de leur action. De plus,
Monsieur Guibert, if you could make some conclusions now, then we'll ask you some questions. Do you want to make some concluding remarks or some summaries?
And then we'll ask je voulais vous dire, sur les différentes infractions, je les avais classées ainsi, je vais donner les titres pour éviter de surcharger. Premièrement, les cinq infractions sont les suivantes.
Please, yeah.
L'accès et le maintien frauduleux dans tout ou partie d'un système de traitement automatisé de données, c'est dans le code pénal. La collecte frauduleuse de données personnelles, c'est aussi dans le code pénal. Troisièmement, l'atteinte à l'intimité de la vie privée d'autrui. Quatrièmement, l'utilisation et la conservation d'enregistrements et de documents obtenus par le moyen d'une atteinte à l'intimité de la vie privée d'autrui. Et cinquièmement, l'atteinte au secret des correspondances électroniques. Donc en conclusion, ce sont bien la NSA et le FBI qui sont les principaux responsables, avec la complicité des sociétés qui ont proposé leurs moyens techniques permettant aux agences américaines d'accéder au contenu des correspondances des internautes. Il est vrai que l'on peut trouver dans d'autres pays que cela n'est pas justiciable, mais il nous a semblé que le fait de déposer une plainte sur ce sujet-là dans notre propre pays pouvait permettre d'engager un combat qui, s'il n'est pas gagné d'avance, est certainement perdu si on ne l'engage pas.
That's extremely helpful. We wanted to get a sense of the case, and that's been very helpful. Mr. Albrecht, do you have a question?
I mean, thank you, first of all, for giving this overview on this procedure and your view on the individual redress. I just would like to know from you what you would like to see or what you would expect from parliamentarians in member states' parliaments and in the European Parliament and on respective governments to happen besides individual redress and individual cases. Thank you.
And maybe if I could just add to that as well, just my other colleagues are going to speak on the Article 8 case, and obviously NGOs have been involved and individuals. So before they come in respect of the situation in France, how much support are you getting in the wider NGO and voluntary community, just to add to Mr. Albrecht's question, and how do you feel you're being supported in the wider civil society, and has there been much media attention? What is your view?
Sur ce que j'attends, ce que nous attendons des parlementaires, c'est de faire évoluer aussi bien la législation au niveau de leur propre pays que de pouvoir porter le débat devant le Parlement européen. Dire que toutes ces procédures sont sans contrôle et se retrouver dans une situation où on nous dit « mais ça ne viendra pas grave puisque tous les pays vont faire la même chose » est quelque chose qui ne peut pas nous convenir. Vous l'avez d'ailleurs dit tout à l'heure, Monsieur Albrecht, ça ne peut pas être une façon de considérer les choses comme correctes, de dire que eh bien, ça va se passer partout et tout le monde aura raison puisque tout le monde le pratiquera. Donc nous attendons des parlementaires nationaux au Parlement européen que non seulement ils fassent tout pour faire progresser la législation de contrôle là-dessus, mais aussi soutiennent l'introduction éventuellement dans la Convention européenne ou la Charte européenne des droits de l'homme, les procédures réglementaires qui nous permettraient d'avancer. Certes, la directive 108 est en train d'évoluer, vous êtes en train de sans doute essayer d'en modifier les aspects, il faudra sans doute faire qu'il puisse y avoir justiciabilité par des individus de ce genre de procédure qui pour l'instant n'existe pas. Pour ce qui est des gouvernements, nos propres gouvernements, nous attendons du gouvernement français, puisque c'est devant lui, devant sa juridiction, qui est déposée la plainte, c'est qu'il il ne fasse pas obstacle à son développement, et deuxièmement, qu'il puisse, sur la base d'un rendu du juge d'instruction et éventuellement d'un passage en procès, qu'il puisse, sur ses rapports de force, peser sur la totalité du champ européen. Mais ça me permet aussi de rajouter que peut-être faudrait-il, il a été souligné tout à l'heure, qu'il fallait faire évoluer les procédures sur le PIDCP. Peut-être faut-il envisager une procédure du type de celle qui a été adoptée avec le protocole facultatif sur le PIDESC qui permet à des gens individuels de finir par porter plainte. Pour l'instant, ce n'est pas le cas pour le PIDCP, mais on pourrait imaginer qu'il y ait le même traitement avec un protocole facultatif qui pourrait se développer sur le PIDCP. Enfin, sur les ONG, en France. Oui, si ça a été déposé au nom de la FIDH et de la LDH, c'est parce que ça permettait à la fois de faire intervenir une organisation nationale, la LDH, mais aussi une organisation internationale, fédérative des organisations de défense des droits de l'homme dans le monde, dont par exemple le Center for Constitutional Rights aux États-Unis. Et posant cette plainte, la LDH et la FIDH, dont le siège est à Paris, voulaient partir de la législation nationale pour essayer d'étendre vers la législation européenne et internationale. Oui, nous pensons être soutenus par à peu près totalité des ONG qui agissent sur ce terrain-là. Nous, d'ailleurs, avons essayé de développer un observatoire des libertés du numérique en France. Vous dire que les médias ont été sensibles à cette plainte, je ne le crois pas. En tout cas, ça n'a pour l'instant pas pris l'aspect d'un débat public. C'est peut-être ce qu'on pourrait demander de plus fort au gouvernement français, c'est d'en faire un débat public, parlementaire et politique.
Thank you very much. I don't know if Mrs. Sipple has a question.
I'm not sure if it's a question. At the beginning of your wording, you made a very sharp link to Lampedusa. And I think what you wanted to point out is that with all the technical possibilities, with all the surveillance mechanisms, everyone can be surveyed, all the data are collected, and to some extent, everyone is a suspect. So you look for data. And you said very clearly that it's intended, or it's said that all this is happening because of terrorism, and for this reason you look for concrete data with some keywords. But as you were very clear in your wording, I would like to ask you, from your personal point of view, are we sure, can we be sure, that the correct keywords are used? We have a wording in Germany, and I think in many other countries, it's like looking for the needle in the haystack. So do we know that we are looking for a needle, and for which needle? And is it true that we look in the correct haystack? Maybe we are lost and looking in the... So would you like to say that all these surveillance measures may be totally misleading beyond the question, it's not correct?
Mr. Guibert, just that will be the final question. And if I could just add one quick question to Mrs. Sipple's question. We also have this issue, I think, in the United Kingdom. I'm going to put it to the two other speakers as well. But I know in France, when we've been doing the hearings, perhaps there is less attention to this issue of PRISM than there is perhaps in Germany, for example. Is that your perception as well, and why do you think that is? And what about the French National Assembly? What has been their reaction? And again, what's your perspective on this? And finally, what is the timing of the proceedings? Just give us a very quick answer on that, please. Thank you. In addition to your answer to Mrs. Sipple.
Je vais essayer sur la question de Madame Sipel. Bien sûr, je pense que c'est orienté vers la sécurité d'un certain point de vue. C'est-à-dire que manifestement, il y a des gens qui sont plus libres que d'autres et d'autres qui sont plus sécurisés, plus contrôlés que d'autres. Et que le contrôle aux frontières est peut-être une image la plus désastreuse qu'on peut avoir de ce concept de sécurité. On pourrait dire que nous disposons d'un certain nombre d'arguments, de moyens techniques absolument extraordinaires pour faire ce qui est fait sur la surveillance d'Internet, et que quand il s'agit de surveiller des pauvres diables qui sont sur la mer en situation de détresse, nous ne savons pas utiliser les moyens techniques pour nous en apercevoir. Nous ne savons pas régler, enfin, en tout cas, la façon de ces faits n'est pas réglée. Et quand c'est réglé, c'est tellement dramatique que ça invite à se poser la question sur ce monde prétendument sûr que nous donneraient tous les concepts technologiques. Ce monde terriblement sûr qui reviendrait à dire que si tout citoyen est contrôlé et si toute frontière est totalement surveillée, le monde est beaucoup plus sûr que ce qu'il était avant. Ce que je conteste, bien évidemment, et qui donne l'idée que la façon dont le contrôle est organisé, avec le secret qui règne sur les mots utilisés, les procédures et autres, est un déni de la démocratie et en général se retourne vers ceux contre ceux qui l'utilisent. Deuxièmement, sur l'actualité politique en France, je vous rassure tout de suite, l'Assemblée nationale travaille. Elle ne travaille pas forcément là-dessus. Et en tout cas, la façon dont elle a peu apporté d'intérêt ou de mise en avant d'une commission, par exemple, d'enquête, en disant, puisque ça s'est produit, y compris sur les citoyens français, ça mériterait une commission d'enquête, mon organisation ne peut que regretter amèrement que les députés n'aient pas jugé intéressant de développer cette commission d'enquête et constater que, dans d'autres pays, il y a peut-être une sensibilité plus importante au contrôle citoyen exercé, y compris par les parlementaires, qui n'existe dans mon pays.
Thank you, Monsieur Guibert, and thank you for your presence here today. It's been really interesting, and please stay for the rest of the session. Our next two speakers are party to the Article 8 ECHR case, which many of you are interested in and have been watching. First of all, Nick Pickles, who's director of Big Brother Watch, which is one of the organisations which has brought the case. So without further ado, Nick Pickles. First, thank you.
Good afternoon, and thank you for the invitation to speak to the committee today. This is an exceptionally important issue, both in the framework of the protection of fundamental rights and the development of a global economy that will be based upon the internet in ways that we didn't foresee many years ago. May I begin by saying that the objective of Big Brother Watch and our litigation in the court is not to bring about the end of surveillance. Our objective is to ensure that, as a democratic state, the United Kingdom's surveillance regime is fit for purpose in a digital age, with a legal framework that citizens can both understand and have confidence in. As I will go on to address, I think at present citizens can neither understand nor have confidence in that legal framework. What Edward Snowden has done is illustrate two key things. Firstly, that the scale and the nature of surveillance is far beyond what national parliaments have legislated for, what legislators have understood as the intent, and that the second part of the operation of surveillance, the safeguards, is that where surveillance powers have been granted, they've been exploited with regard to the internet far beyond the intention of legislators, and to a degree that few would recognise as feature of a civil society, and oversight mechanisms have proved woefully ill-equipped to perform their tasks. Briefly, in the past week, there have been remarks from the director of the British Intelligence Services about the value to our enemies. And I would like to just briefly highlight the quotes from Nigel Inkster, a former deputy chief of MI6, who told The Guardian, "I sense that those most interested in the activities of the NSA and GCHQ have not been told very much that they didn't already know could not have inferred." Edward Snowden has performed a great public service, and I hope initiated a debate that will not remain confined to these hearings. Indeed, perhaps the starkest demonstration of how the scale of surveillance has exceeded the intent of legislators is the current efforts of Representative Jim Sinsbrenner, the Republican and co-author of the Patriot Act, who is attempting to significantly reduce the scope of that legislation, having now learned that the law he helped draft has been implied in a very different way and far beyond what he or Congress intended. The response of the US government, from the president down, to reform the law, enhance oversight, and improve transparency demonstrates the very real public interest in these disclosures. It also highlights how the legal and oversight frameworks are not fit for purpose. It is a great shame that the same debate is not taking place in Britain, and I'm sure we will come up with that in questions. However, I would like to note that despite the apparent lack of interest, when we launched our legal action, in a matter of days, we had raised our fundraising target, with hundreds of people joining our cause and spreading word of their legal action. So while people may say that the public are not talking about this, I would argue that they are talking about it. It's the media that is currently letting them down. Debate may be denied by some, but it is not a debate the public wish to ignore. The UK's arrangements with regard to PRISM have been examined by the Intelligence and Security Committee of Parliament. However, they did not examine Tempora, and Tempora is the primary element of our legal action under Article 8. The committee did not mention Tempora in its report into PRISM, so we cannot infer whether the committee was not aware of its existence or did just chose not to acknowledge it. There are serious concerns, as Professor Korff has already noted, about GCHQ's legal oversight and the requirement under Article 8 that the infringements in Article 8, sorry, should be prescribed by law, necessary and proportionate, is far from clear that the UK is compliant in these issues, and this is the central argument of our legal action launched with fellow British NGOs, the Open Rights Group and English Pen, and with Constanze. We did initially seek to bring this action in the UK courts, and I think that, as we've heard about domestic remedies, it would be in a great public interest to have this debate in British courts. However, our attempts to have this debate were refused, and we were pointed to the Investigatory Powers Tribunal, a secretive and closed tribunal. We thought that, based on previous remarks of the European Court of Human Rights in Kennedy, that this was not an effective remedy, particularly given that views of this tribunal cannot be appealed to a higher British court, and it is unable to make a declaration of incompatibility about statutes with respect to the Human Rights Act and the Convention. So in our case, we submit that technologies have now been developed and for some time have been in use, which do permit the indiscriminate capture of vast quantities of communications data and content, which can be passed between states, which is not subject to any sufficiently precise or ascertainable legal framework and is beyond effective legal scrutiny. We contend that the reported activities of GCHQ constitute a violation of Article 8 of the European Convention, and in relation to the receipt of foreign intercept material, the legal framework is inadequate to comply with the in accordance with the law requirement under Article 8 too. As part of our submission, there are legal expert statements from both the US and the UK from Cindy Cohn and Ian Brown, and I would urge you all to read their testimony, particularly the note that from Ian Brown about the breadth of the potential legal authorization, which highlights that it is possible that a typical warrant authorizing the Tempora program may be as wide as simply discussing all traffic passing along a specified cable between the UK and the US. In a presentation in 2011, a GCHQ legal advisor told NSA analysts that one of the reasons for using Tempora was that the UK's had a light oversight regime compared to the US. Indeed, the unique selling point of the UK's legal regime is mentioned in some of the presentations disclosed. And if there is any statement worthy of examination and investigation, it must be this. As we submit in the documents outlining the grounds for our claim, what is required is a framework that enables citizens to understand with sufficient clarity the types of person and conduct in relation to whom surveillance may occur, the safeguards which exist and govern dissemination and sharing of such material, the framework which exists to guard against arbitrary or disproportionate use of such material, and checks on the authority required to permit such surveillance and limits on the time for which such surveillance may occur. What is required is a legal framework which provides an ascertainable check against arbitrary use of secret and intrusive state surveillance. I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nick. And we go straight to Constanze Kurz. Constanze, just to introduce you, is a computer scientist and project leader at the University of Applied Science and Technology and Economy in Berlin, but mainly is an applicant in this case. So if you give us your perspective, thank you.
Ja, vielen Dank für die Einladung. Ich habe, bevor ich zu meinem Statement komme, vielleicht noch eine Information. die diesen Ausschuss interessieren wird, weil in der ersten Session sich darauf bezogen wurde, nämlich auf den UN Human, also die UN Human Rights Committee, auf deren Website ist gerade die aktuelle Information, dass wegen des US-Government Shutdowns diese Anhörung wohl nicht stattfindet. Hier wurde sich ja im ersten Teil darauf bezogen. Ich möchte die Gelegenheit nutzen, über das hinaus, was Nick Pickles gesagt hat, Stellung zu beziehen zu den bekannt gewordenen Praktiken der Geheimdienste, insbesondere zum GCHQ, weil aus meiner Sicht auch als Beschwerdeführerin in dem Fall natürlich wegen der Europäischen Menschenrechtskonvention andere Voraussetzungen herrschen als etwa bei den amerikanischen Geheimdiensten, denn wir haben in den vergangenen Monaten gelernt, dass die technischen Möglichkeiten, alle digitalen Transaktionen und den gesamten Netzverkehr von Kontinenten abzuhören, nicht nur technisch vorhanden sind, sondern dass sie auch genutzt werden, und zwar hier mitten in Europa und nicht nur in Diktaturen. Nick Pickles sprach ja schon kurz über Tempora-Programm, das sich eben vor allen Dingen an den überwachten Glasfaserleitungen gütlich tut und wo ja der gesamte Netzverkehr über mehrere Tage gespeichert wird, um ihn zu analysieren und zu filtern. Diesen Fall bringen wir also jetzt oder versuchen wir nach Straßburg zu bringen zu den Fragen der Betroffenheit, die vorher schon angesprochen wurden. So habe ich aus meiner Sicht keine Zweifel, dass ich zu den Betroffenen gehöre. Ich bin ein normaler, sozusagen digitaler Bürger, ungefähr 18 Stunden am Tag online, und ich weiß, dass ungefähr 85% meiner Kommunikation über genau diese Glasfaserleitungen gehen, also in die Bulk Mass Surveillance unmittelbar einfließen. Neben dem, was Nick Pickles schon sagte zu dem Fall, ist mein primärer Antrieb, nach Straßburg zu ziehen, auch überhaupt an Fakten und Informationen zu kommen. In Fällen, die wir vor dem deutschen Bundesverfassungsgericht verhandelt haben, kam es immer wieder dazu, wenn die Geheimdienste dort Stellung nehmen mussten, dass auch Informationen über das hinaus, was aus den Snowden-Unterlagen jetzt bekannt ist, veröffentlicht werden müssen. Und meine Hoffnung ist natürlich, dass das Verfahren, wenn es zu einem kommt, in Straßburg auch Informationen herausbringt, denn nicht nur sicherlich nicht nur die deutsche Regierung, auch die anderen Regierungen in Europa haben sich nicht gerade dadurch hervorgetan, zu den Veröffentlichungen von Snowden Informationen hinzuzufügen, die ein Mehr an Aufklärung bringen würden. Das heißt, neben der Frage, ob im Einzelnen nach britischem Recht die Maßnahmen der Überwachung irgendwie notwendig, verhältnismäßig oder auch nur zielführend sind, geht es mir vor allen Dingen um die Frage, ob diese Regelung in Großbritannien, den GCHQ betreffend, also nationale britische Recht, das Kommunikationsgeheimnis des Großteils der Europäer betrifft und damit, also untergräbt letztlich und damit auch internationales Recht bricht. Denn wie wir wissen, der britische Geheimdienst muss für das Belauschen ausländischer Kommunikation, also etwa meiner und ihrer, also von europäischen Bürgern, Unternehmen, eben gerade keinerlei Zielpersonen benennen oder auch sonst keine Sachgründe vorlegen. Sie sind also im Prinzip überwachungsvogelfrei als Ausländer. Und wenn jetzt die Mitglieder der britischen und der US-amerikanischen Regierung ankündigen, wenigstens mal darüber nachdenken zu wollen, die parlamentarische Kontrolle in ihren Ländern zu verbessern, dann ist natürlich hier nur an die Inländer gedacht und eben nicht an Personen wie mich, die Ausländer sind und von diesen Gesetzen betroffen. Für den Schutz vor der massenhaften Überwachung durch den GCHQ bedeutet das konkret, dass der Rest der Europäer natürlich weiterhin außen vor wäre, selbst wenn es Verbesserungen in der Gesetzgebung und der parlamentarischen Kontrolle käme. Das betrifft nicht nur das Belauschen, sondern das betrifft aus meiner Sicht auch schon die Fälle, zu denen ich gleich noch mal kurz kommen möchte, das Hacking, also die aktiven Angriffe der Geheimdienste auf Infrastrukturen betreffen. Wir wissen also nach den veröffentlichten Snowden-Unterlagen, die im Übrigen ja auch nicht dementiert sind, dass der europäische Internetverkehr durch den GCHQ fast vollständig erfasst und analysiert wird. Insbesondere betrifft das die Überseekabel und mindestens 2 Dutzend weitere Glasfaserleitungen, darunter auch innereuropäische. will bei dieser Gelegenheit darauf hinweisen, dass es also nicht nur wie vorher diskutiert um das Speichern der Daten geht, was legalistisch zu betrachten wäre, sondern natürlich auch um die Tatsache, dass man, um an diese Daten zu kommen, die zu speichern und zu analysieren, zunächst mal diese Leitungen anzapfen muss. Es stellen sich natürlich auch Fragen an die Betreiber, Firmenkonsortien dieser Leitungen, die das Abhören nicht dementieren, aber auch keine Auskünfte dazu geben, obwohl nicht nur britische Betreiber dieser Glasfaserleitung betroffen sind, sondern auch ausländische Unternehmen wie etwa Verizon, Interroute oder die Deutsche Telekom, die aber dennoch auf die Verschwiegenheitsverpflichtung nach britischem Recht verweisen und anders als etwa einige amerikanische Unternehmen nicht ihrerseits rechtliche Schritte gegen diese Verpflichtung vornehmen. Wir haben heute viel über die Überwachung gesprochen. Ich möchte aber gerne neben diesen Fragen, die die Eingriffe in die Privatsphäre von Menschen betreffen, auch darüber sprechen, wie wir mit den offensiven Angriffen auf kritische Infrastrukturen von Nachbarländern umgehen. Der Fall des geheimdienstlichen Hackings von Belgacom ist hier schon angesprochen worden. Wir reden hier also nicht davon, dass es primär darum geht, dort Daten zu erlangen. Das ist zwar das Ziel, aber was eigentlich getan wurde, ist nicht Spionage, sondern ein aktiver Angriff, bei dem eine große Zahl der Rechner von Belgacom kompromittiert wurden. Und zwar so weit kompromittiert wurden, dass die Rechte des ausländischen Dienstes hier so weit reichten, dass im Prinzip alle Administratorfunktionen auf diesen Rechnern benutzt werden konnten. Das ist also ganz klar ein Angriff auf die nationale Souveränität eines befreundeten EU-Landes. Die Computer dieses belgischen Unternehmens, Belgacom, das teilweise in Staatsbesitz ist, wurde also heimlich mit professioneller Schadsoftware infiltriert, um an sämtliche Passwörter und auch an die kryptografischen Schlüssel zu kommen und diese abzugreifen. Die Informationen dazu, wenn Sie sie nachlesen möchten, finden sich in der Presse, vor allen Dingen in der belgischen. Da habe ich in der Stellungnahme kurz verlinkt. Ich will nur darauf hinweisen, Kunden von Belgacom sind unter anderem Sie als EU-Parlament und die Europäische Kommission, aber auch zum Beispiel die Betreiber von SWIFT oder die NATO. Wir haben hier also nicht nur die nationale Souveränität betroffen, die durch diese Hacking-Angriffe in Frage gestellt wurde, sondern eben auch internationale Organisationen. Dazu würde man auch noch das bisher noch nicht erwähnte ECHR-Programm, das GCHQ, erwähnen müssen. Das ist sozusagen das britische Pendant von Bullrun, dem NSA-System. Mit ECHR führt der britische Geheimdienst ein systematisches Untergraben und Umgehen von Verschlüsselungsmaßnahmen durch, bis heute. Daran ändert sich ja auch nichts. Wir debattieren zwar über die Überwachung und das Hacking, aber die Programme werden ja weitergeführt und man kann dieses ECHR-Programm ohne Zweifel als ein ganz großes Antisicherheitsprogramm begreifen und auch als eine generelle Unterminierung des Vertrauens und die alltägliche Kommunikation über die Netze, die dadurch nachhaltig kompromittiert wird. Hier hat man die typischen geheimdienstlichen Methoden gesehen. Man hat also versucht, Hintertüren in Verschlüsselungsalgorithmen einzubauen. Man hat V-Männer eingeschleust, was halt so Geheimdienste machen. Und man zielt insbesondere auf die Service-Provider wie Hotmail, Yahoo, Google, Facebook. Ich will vielleicht zum Schluss kommen. Sie können weitere Bemerkungen von mir natürlich gerne in der Stellungnahme nachlesen. Ich bin natürlich der Auffassung, dass wir mit dem nun vorhandenen detaillierten Wissen von den kaum durch irgendwelche Kontrollen behinderten Geheimdiensten, dass wir uns damit nicht abfinden dürfen. Und selbstverständlich einer der Gründe, warum meine Mitstreiter und ich diese Beschwerde vor dem Europäischen Gerichtshof vorgelegt haben. Dennoch müssen wir aus meiner Sicht politische Antworten finden, die darauf hinauslaufen, dass zumindest die europäischen Regierungen dem Fernmeldegeheimnis und dem Recht auf eine digitale Privatsphäre einen deutlich höheren Stellenwert einräumen und so etwas wie digitale Nicht-Angriffspakte untereinander geschlossen werden, sodass die Integrität der technischen Infrastrukturen gegenseitig nicht kompromittiert wird. Vielleicht als letzte Bemerkung zu dieser Heuhaufen-Analogie, die wir jetzt häufig hören. Ich darf daran erinnern, dass sowohl der jetzige wie auch der vergangene Chef der NSA immer wieder darauf hingewiesen hat, dass es gerade nicht um die Nadel im Heuhaufen geht, sondern dass es darum geht, den gesamten Heuhaufen aufzuzeichnen. Und ich denke, gegen diese Ideologie müssen wir uns wehren und wir werden es vor Gericht mal versuchen.
Okay, thank you very much, Constanze. We'll go straight to questions from my colleagues, beginning with Axel Voss.
Vielen Dank, Entschuldigung, vielen Dank, Herr Pickles, vielen Dank, Frau Kurz, für die Erläuterungen. Ich habe in dem Zusammenhang zwei Fragen, und zwar, also zunächst, warum wir uns eigentlich hauptsächlich immer mit der amerikanischen Seite und weniger mit der britischen Seite befassen, liegt wohl mehr daran, dass Herr Snowden nun mal bei der NSA gearbeitet hat und dort die Dokumente auch offenlegt, während wir das auf der britischen Seite immer nur sozusagen als Folgewirkung dort haben. Aber ich wollte Sie an sich fragen, wo sehen Sie oder wo legen Sie eigentlich die Grenzen oder wo würden Sie sie hinlegen zwischen der Privatsphäre und der allgemeinen Sicherheit, auch was das Internet betrifft? Ich habe mittlerweile das Gefühl, durch diese technologischen digitalen Dinge kann man eigentlich das Internet ja gar nicht mehr unbedingt als privates Medium irgendwie sehen, sondern da muss man ja mehr den öffentlichen Raum sehen. Und wo würden Sie da vielleicht solche Grenzen ziehen? Und das andere wäre die Frage, wo würden Sie die Grenzen legen, wann Staaten zur Strafverfolgung oder auch zur Gefahrenabwehr auf Datensammlungen privater zugreifen kann oder darf?
I think, Constanze, that was addressed to you. So do you want to just reply to that?
Sure. Vielleicht zu der ersten Frage der allgemeinen Sicherheit im Internet. Ich denke, man muss sich klar machen, dass wir in Bezug auf Sicherheitslücken, auf die strukturelle Unterminierung von Sicherheitsmethoden, die ja vor allen Dingen für uns alle im alltäglichen Kommunizieren und natürlich auch in der Wirtschaft Verschlüsselungsverfahren sind, dass wir hier davon reden, dass die Geheimdienste der Amerikaner und der Briten diese Sicherheit strukturell unterminieren. Denn zumindest einige der gängigen Verschlüsselungsverfahren sind durch Hintertüren oder durch die strukturelle Schwächung der Standards dieser Verschlüsselungsverfahren im Prinzip nicht mehr als sicher zu betrachten. Das heißt, wir reden hier eigentlich davon, dass die Kommunikation der Bürger, aber auch die Kommunikation natürlich zwischen Behörden oder Unternehmen strukturell unterminiert worden ist und hält auch weiterhin an. Aus meiner Sicht ist da aber auch noch ein anderer Bereich, den man erwähnen sollte. Sie wissen sicher, mit Sicherheitslücken gegen gängige Betriebssysteme und gängige Browser, die häufig die Angriffswege sind, um Computersysteme anzugreifen. In diesem Bereich existiert schon lange ein grauer Markt und ein schwarzer Markt. Das heißt, diese Sicherheitslücken werden gekauft und verkauft. Und Teil der Snowden-Enthüllung ist auch, dass im Wesentlichen dieser Schwarzmarkt von den staatlichen Behörden bedient wird. Das heißt, die Geheimdienste kaufen diese Sicherheitslücken und lassen diesen Markt an Exploits, wie diese Sicherheitslücken häufig genannt werden, überhaupt erst am Leben. Das heißt, wir sehen hier eigentlich ein wir müssten eigentlich unsere Cybercrime-Communities gegen die Geheimdienste wenden, damit sie diese strukturelle Unsicherheit strafrechtlich verfolgen. Zu Ihrer zweiten Frage. Selbstverständlich bin ich der Ansicht, dass digitale Daten zur Strafverfolgung genutzt werden dürfen. Dafür gibt es auch in allen Ländern in Europa Gesetze. Das betrifft auch die Daten etwa von Privatunternehmen, auf die sehr wohl zugegriffen werden darf. Wogegen ich mich, wie sehr viele meiner Vorredner wende, ist selbstverständlich die anlasslose Festhalten von Daten aus präventiven Gründen.
Do you have a, Jan, do you have a question?
Ja, vielen Dank fürs Hiersein und auch für die Ausführungen und für die Antworten jetzt. Ich würde eigentlich ganz gerne eine Frage nur stellen, und zwar, wenn man sich diese Überwachungsprogramme ansieht, Tempora, Prism und so weiter, wie sie auch alle heißen, unterschiedliche Richtungen, unterschiedliche Technik, aber Mir stellt sich die Frage, wie wahrscheinlich vielen Menschen da draußen, was genau passiert da und was ist damit vergleichbar, wenn man es auf die analoge Welt sozusagen überträgt? Das ist jetzt eine große Frage, aber ich glaube, dass sie in dieser Runde bisher vielleicht noch nicht so beantwortet wurde und ich würde mir wünschen, da ein Stück weit einen Einblick zu bekommen, weil das ja auch die Frage ist, wie betrifft das den Einzelnen, der hier ja auch quasi individuell betroffen sein könnte oder ist, in seinen Grundrechten und welche Auswirkungen hat das auf die Demokratie? It's to both of you, if you want to.
Yeah. I think this touches on the first question, actually. The scale question. This is something where surveillance itself is not new. And to your question, Mr. Voss, of the something being in the public sphere, I don't think people doubt that. What's different here is this isn't an individual target. This isn't a string of evidence being followed in an investigation. This is collecting everything just in case and then sifting through it using the kind of profiling that Mr. Korff touched on earlier on, which can lead to a huge number of false positives and false negatives. Then you have the questions, of course, around what's in the national interest. Well, if you listen to the comments of Mark Zuckerberg only a few weeks ago, he very rightly pointed out that if a strong economy is in the national interest, now businesses are not national entities. They have customers around the world. Indeed, most of their customers may not be in the country they are based in. So to simply say, and this follows Constance's point, that it's just about the foreigners, don't worry about our own citizens, actually significantly undermines the national interest because it makes you a much less attractive place for someone to run a business. Mr. Albrecht's point, I think, this is the fulcrum of where rights and technology become a huge problem, because what is now possible in terms of processing, in terms of volume of data, means that in Britain we have the Law Regulation of Investigatory Powers Act, written in the year 2000, which talks of these external communications, but that was written at a time where it was copper telephone cable, not fiber optic internet cable. So you have old law being applied to new situations and new technology, which then enables a scale of surveillance which is unprecedented and, personally speaking, I do not think was intended by legislators either in the US or in the UK.
Also ich würde nur eine kurze Bemerkung machen zu der letzten Frage. Natürlich gibt es aus meiner Sicht als Technikerin keine Entsprechung in der physischen Welt für die Möglichkeiten, die man heute durch eine digitale Überwachung haben kann. Ich glaube auch, dass jedem bewusst ist, wir haben längst mehr Smartphones als Menschen in Europa, dass diese Form von digitaler Aufzeichnung von Alltagsaktivitäten keine analogen Vergleichssysteme mehr hat. Natürlich, also mich triggert die Frage, ganz kleinen Blick in die Zukunft zu werfen. Wir sollten uns natürlich klar machen, dass nicht nur die Computer kleiner werden, in unsere Körper wachsen und dass die Geräte, mit denen wir uns geben, aber auch die Dinge, mit denen wir im Büro und zu Hause arbeiten, auch aktive, Informationen sammelnde Gerätschaften sein werden in Zukunft, in einer relativ schnellen Zukunft. Also in 3 bis 5 Jahren, also dass wir natürlich die Problematik, die wir heute besprechen über diese massenhafte Abhören, vor allen Dingen auch vor dem Hintergrund debattieren müssen, dass wenn wir es jetzt nicht stoppen, sich letztlich auch auf eine uns ubiquitär umgebende digitale Umgebung überspringen wird, die kommt, die schon beginnt. Vielleicht würde ich als Letztes noch verweisen auf die Studie von Mr. Muller, der, um nochmal zu dieser Sicherheitsfrage, die Sie hatten, zurückzukommen, der untersucht hat, die 53 letzten Terroranschläge oder Terrorversuche in den USA, in denen sämtlich keiner der Geheimdienste dazu beitrug, die zu verhindern oder aufzuklären, sondern, wie immer, eine ordentliche, gute Strafverfolger- und Polizeiarbeit.
Feeling stressed enough. Thanks, Constanze. Ana Gomez.
I would like to ask you, what would you, from your angle as a scientist and having knowing the implications, including for the future, what would you suggest we ask from the U.S. and also our authorities who are actually engaging in this kind of practices? Is it about, you mentioned a pact of non-attack, but is that pact going to be worth more than the existing data privacy law that they do not respect? Or the broader international law, confidence and so on, that they do not respect, obviously? Is it about increasing the parliamentary scrutiny so that indeed they, at the national level, it will be indeed, and at the whatever level, there will be monitoring of what is being happening? Is it also in what concerns the U.S. redress for European citizens that simply is not existing? So, what else?
Can I ask if there are any other members who have got questions, and I can do a job lot. Can I just ask Nick in particular, I mean, this case, it wouldn't have gone without notices coming from the UK. It's an interesting case which, I mean, for those who don't know, it cuts across party political lines, which I think is a very, well, it's a good thing. I think objectively that can be said. And the question I have, I mean, your presentation and Constanze's presentation, by the way, is on the website, so I don't want to ask questions which, you know, are clearly set out in your very clear presentation. So I really want to ask the question about what you perceive is going to be changed by the action. I mean, obviously, judicially, we'll see what happens, but politically, what can be changed? We discussed in the first presentation what effect this case is having in France compared to where it's taken more seriously in Germany. There is a problem in the UK for all sorts of political, cultural reasons. What do you perceive is going to change here? I mean, I see Jacob Applebaum is here. He spoke about this sort of demarcation between how people talk about security, the line between security and freedom, and whether that's even, if I remember his description, whether that's even a kind of a line people should draw, and all sorts of questions like this. But in the UK, I perceive that this case has been taken, but already, if you don't mind me saying, objectively, it's already been lost. I mean, are people really focusing on this? And if they are, what do they perceive that you're trying to achieve? This may seem like a naive question, but if this is going to go beyond, you know, an inquiry like this or similar national inquiries to really be meaningful to people, what is it that they are going to achieve or you seek to achieve for a citizen? If you can, because you've been very articulate in your presentation, but try and encapsulate it for this inquiry, for the web stream, as to what it would achieve politically if judicially it hits a wall. You know, what would you achieve from the case?
I think, as Constanze has already alluded to, one of the fundamental problems here is a lack of information about what has happened. The US government, to its limited credit, has at least declassified some legal opinions. We've seen some movement towards greater transparency, towards some movement of allowing companies to inform their customers about what is going on. And I think that debate will come in the UK. The Intelligence and Security Committee itself said it has doubts as to whether the existing legal framework is adequate. I think we do have a problem that our safeguards are currently seen as very closed, very establishment bodies. The idea of ordinary citizens bringing legal action is something which has not been a pressing public issue in the UK for a range of reasons. I think that there's two important points. Firstly, Britain prides itself on having the mother of parliaments, and our foreign secretary has led the way in terms of foreign policy about having frameworks at home that, if they are copied around the world, protect the rights of journalists, of human rights activists, of politicians, to ensure a civil society. And I think we are very dangerously coming close to a point where we did not have the moral authority to make those kind of assertions in a way that we have done to the credit of this government. And I think the second part is, it's Mr. Albrecht's point. People have not yet perceived the scale of what is going on. And if the legal action does not succeed in its primary aim, and based on the rulings of Kennedy and other cases, I think we do have a good chance, then at least I hope we can inform the debate in Britain to a point where the public realise, as they have in Germany and in the US, that this is an enormously significant issue, and that you see the cross-party concern in other countries come to the fore. And I think we're moving in that direction, but perhaps less, with less pace than I and others would like.
Colleagues, are there any other questions? Birgit, do you have anything? Okay, I think we're drawing to the close. In shock, we're closing before the end of time, but sorry to anyone watching on the web stream, this is like just shock from the chair that we're not over time. Could I just particularly thank the members who have attended, and particularly to Birgit Sippel, Jan Albrecht, Mr. Voss, for attending every single hearing. I think it's a remarkable thing to do, all 8 hearings. I particularly want to thank them for doing that, and thank our speakers again for their excellent contributions in this session, and to all the, and could I thank, just take this opportunity, it has been web streamed, to thank, this is the 8th hearing, to thank our secretariat for their excellent efforts in particular, and all of our staff as well. Just on this 8th hearing, it's been a remarkable effort. The speakers don't know what I'm talking about, but you're here as a result of their excellent efforts, so thank you again. I'm not going to be in the chair again, so this is just my chance to do it. Thank you.
Through me, there was no clock. So I had no idea how long I'd been speaking for. Just saying, the clock didn't come up.